Hello everyone, and today we're going to be talking about the fourth studio album by recording artist Post Malone, 12 Karat Toothache. This album was released in the summer of 2022, 3 years after the release of his previous album to that, Hollywood's Bleeding. This was also his first album post-COVID, and his struggles during quarantine are put on full display in this album as well. While he has made projects and appeared on projects in the interim, it seems that for the 3 years between these albums, Post Malone did lose a lot of his creative drive or inspiration to make music. And in interviews, he has confirmed his struggles with writer's block during this time and his lack of motivation or inspiration. That was until this album, where he poured all of his heart and all of his struggles into one amazing album.
I love making music. For the longest time, I didn't have any fun anymore. And now I'm happy and I love making music.
Now, I have done album analyses like this in the past, which you can watch on this channel. And those albums go over more of a narrative structure. There is more of a story that can be tracked between the songs of the albums to form a grander story. And this is not the case with this album. There is no cohesive narrative, but there is a story that this album is trying to tell. It is the raw experience of a man facing his demons head on and putting his heart on full display for everyone to listen to. And so consider this your content warning. This album is very personal and deals with a lot of mental health issues. And so we will be exploring topics such as addiction, depression, and thoughts of ending said depression. Not in a good way. So if that's not something you want to interact with today, then I would sit this video out, save it for later, or watch it another time when you're feeling up to it. It is a story of fame and the pain that it causes. It is a story of love, obsession, and addiction. This is the story of 12 Karat Toothache.
But first, a word from our sponsor. I'm on a mission to make content creation my job, and to do that, I need your help. In the description, there is a link to my Patreon where you can support me in exchange for benefits, as well as a link to my Twitch channel where you can support me through subscriptions and bits, as well as a PayPal if you're feeling generous. Thanks for listening to my speech, and we're gonna get back to the video.
And for those who have seen my album analyses in the past, you'll know that I don't really I've never really included lyrics or lines that use any kind of foul language, partly because it just worked out that way, but also because they didn't enhance the actual video or the message I was trying to talk about. But in this video, I am going to be including lines that have foul language in them because I do think that they are important to the point that I'm trying to make and the point that he's trying to make in this album, that Post is making in the album. So I will be including lyrics from the songs that do have some foul language in them, just so you're aware. Most people don't care about foul language in videos. I myself don't use foul language in videos, but I'm going to be including lines from the songs that do. This is mainly just a warning for my mother, who I know is going to watch this video, so you have been warned. I want to say this before we get into the tracks themselves, but I believe that throughout this album, we hear two different sides of Post Malone singing throughout the album. There is Post Malone, the famous record artist who rose to fame through his songs about partying and women and such. And then there is Austin Post, his honest persona, who he truly is. And we will see in these tracks that these two personas are at odds with each other throughout the entire album. An album that all begins with a track by Austin called Reputation. In a rather bold move for someone who was considered a hip-hop artist, Post Malone begins his album with a piano ballad. And in this first track, he puts all of his cards immediately on the table for all to see. Under intense pressure from his fans to release more music for them to listen to, he feels as though he has to give a piece of himself, sacrifice a piece of himself, in order to make others happy, to make his fans happy. In order to help others through his music, he has to sacrifice his own mental health in order to provide that music. He also expresses his exhaustion with his lifestyle of binge drinking just to throw it up and do it all again.
Save my own life just to save us. Drink it all down just to throw it up.
Now, up until this point, the drinking and the partying has been a very glamorous aspect of Post Malone's songs. One of his albums is literally titled Beer Bongs and Bentleys. He used to revel in this lifestyle of excess and abuse, substance abuse. Yet here, he seems very jaded by it, and this is a recurring theme throughout the album. He's feeling very pressured musically. He is largely known as this famous artist who makes hits after hits after hits. And while this used to give him confidence, now it feels as though the world is just incessantly poking him with a stick, demanding that he make more music.
I got a reputation that I can't deny.
People are demanding the world of him, but he is just begging them not to wake him up. He is tired and he is not in a great headspace. He needs to be left alone, but the people want what they want. And who is they? Who are the people? I don't know. Fans? Haters? It could be anyone. In this state of mind, he feels as though the whole world is against him. He also has this very interesting line. And I think this line is him referring to the two personalities that I talked about, Post Malone and Austin, although not in a literal psychological sense. With this line, he is putting some distance between these two personalities. I believe that he is talking about the ways that Post Malone has ruined and betrayed Austin, ruining his life with the excess abuse of alcohol and substances. And this schism between his personalities leads to the first instance in the album of the concept of killing an aspect of oneself or killing an idea about one's self.
Kill myself today. Kill it all away.
And in this context, I do believe that this is referring to Post Malone slowly and painfully killing off the Austin side of him, who is crying out in this song desperately. It seems as though he is now destined to walk this path that he made himself. And as part of his plea, with the voices of everyone crowding around him demanding more music, all he asks,
"Broken path.
He acknowledges that he has messed up in a large way, and that he is now destined to walk this path that he has laid out for himself with these terrible choices that he's made. Full of regrets and remorse, he finally resigns himself to what is ahead of him.
Watch yourself, I can't slow down. This is who I am, can't be anyone else.
He is incapable of slowing down, and so he begs everyone around him to distance themselves from him before it's too late, and he drags them down with him. In this state of despair, he has the thought that maybe he was born for this life. Maybe he was born to cause mayhem, do drugs, drink all day.
I was born to raise hell. I was born to take pills. I was born to chase meals. I was born to cave in. I was born to fight hoes. I was born to fight God. I was born to... What a shame.
But out of all his regrets, the biggest one, sadly, is the day that he was born. He finishes his song by begging everyone to stay away from him and just let him choke on his cigarettes in peace, as well as the enormous debt he has accrued from his reckless spending habits.
Let me choke on my cigarettes and heavy debt.
Moving on to track two, Cooped Up. this track is sung by Post Malone, and rather than being very insecure and reluctant as he was in the first track, now he is back with full confidence. He's been cooped up by quarantine for so long, but now he is back, and he has immediately dived back headlong into the partying lifestyle. And I've been waiting so long, now I gotta resurface. Having drank all the beer, he's upgraded to bourbon, and when the cops show up at the door to see what's going on, he flushes all of his drugs down the toilet. He's clothing himself once again in expensive designer clothes, and he is ready to party. And then there's the feature by Roddy Ricch, who talks about these lavish parties filled with alcohol and women and drugs. Got black minks all on the road, whoa, whoa. Got hella hoes popping drugs. And everyone at the party is rich. Everybody at the party is famous. He also references the role that Post Malone had played in his own success. And this is where I went down a little bit of a rabbit hole of the relationship between Post Malone and Roddy Ricch. I have no idea who Roddy is. I just went down the rabbit hole. And through that, I found out that Roddy was fairly well known, but only really enjoyed moderate success. His biggest achievement being a festival that he performed in 2018. And in 2019, Post Malone invited him on his European leg of the Beer Bongs and Bentleys tour. Together, him, Post Malone, and Tyler Yahweh all sold out arenas and helped to elevate each other's own success. Post Malone comes back into the track and says that they will party all night. He's got bourbon in his stomach, cigarette smoke filling his lungs, and he has no plans of stopping anytime soon. To the day I come, to the day I come. Hakasaki and Watsumi, cigarette in my lungs. It's 11 in the morning and we still ain't done. And I'm still that bitch, so we then come to the next track of the album, Lemon Tree. This track is sung by Austin with the accompaniment of his acoustic guitar. And in this track, he is trying to break out of this depressed state that he's been in for so long, and struggling with these bouts of insomnia. He also appears to be talking to a former romantic partner, and part of the reason that he struggles to sleep at night is that he never knew what she wanted in the relationship. They never communicated well. Couldn't fall asleep all night. I tried with all my might. I thought I knew what you want. And over time, she began to become sour towards him, and the relationship began to rot from the inside, just like his own heart has been rotten for a long time. And he reflects on how in this poor mental state, he sees a piece of himself in all the villains that he sees in TV and movies. And so he asks her to stay or to come back and show him the good side of him once again. So turn around and show me that I'm better. And then the chorus goes into a little bit of metaphor. All the English teachers in the audience perking their ears up like, oh. Metaphor. In the chorus, he talks about how most people are growing apple trees or tangerine trees, which is representative of people having a confident or at least a positive state of mind. And all these people are content with what they've been given because they have it so good. And he's very bitter about this because he is stuck with a lemon tree. In other words, his mind and his thoughts are very sour and poisoning him from the inside. Life is pretty sweet, I'm told. I get some shit out of luck growing a lemon tree. And so, as a promise to himself, he resolves to burn that tree down and grow something better for himself. Life has constantly beat him to the ground, and he takes some morbid comfort in the fact that he will one day ultimately return to the ground. But for now, he resolves to survive and endure. And now we come to the track, Wrapped Around Your Finger. Now, this song, I believe, is largely about a breakup. Now, some sources that I used in analyzing this song seem to think that being wrapped around her finger is referring to the fact that she was very manipulative and controlling of him, but that's not really the impression I get from the song. It seems more like he was wrapped around her finger in the sense of his adoration of her when they were together. He talks about how he was caught up in her orbit until he was eventually shot back down to Earth. In other words, they were very happy together for a time until she one day broke things off and sent him spiraling. I was wrapped around your finger, wrapped around your finger, then I shot back down to Earth. And he tells himself that he's not gonna call her because he knows that he's been drinking, and if he does talk to her, he'll be completely honest about what he... how he's feeling. I can call you right now, I've been drinking, and I know that I say what I'm thinking. And he wonders to himself why he constantly tells himself that he'll move on eventually, because he knows full well that she doesn't care anymore. Why do I tell myself that I do the best I can? I know damn well that you couldn't give a damn. He knows because of the level of fame that he has that there are plenty of women who would be willing to be with him just because of that, but he knows that if she were to call him up one last time, he wouldn't be able to say no. He wonders to himself if she has found someone else by now, and he wishes that he could go back to a time when they were together and happy. See, it's lines like this in the song that make me question why other sources would think that she was very, like, harmful, manipulative, and controlling. Because in this song, he seems like he genuinely misses her and still cares about her. Now, I do know that victims of abuse can have this effect done to them, but I don't really think that that's what we're meant to take out of this song. There's nothing in this song that indicates to me that this was ever the case. And he reflects on when he first met this woman. She didn't know that he was the famous, legendary Post Malone. She had no idea he was a singer, and she wasn't fazed at all by the expensive things that he wore. When we met, you ain't know I was a singer. You weren't impressed by the ice on my fingers. She was special to him. She didn't care about any of the superficial wealth things. She just loved him for him. She had no idea that the rings that he wore on his fingers were worth more than her parents' house. And he wonders if he might be in the same headspace if he had known that the relationship would be ending. If I didn't know what it'd be like now, I wouldn't be in misery right now. He looks in the mirror, but he doesn't recognize himself, and he thinks to himself that being with him has got to be a living hell. And despite trying to move on, this woman still has a hold on him. He is still wrapped around her finger, in a sense. In his own words, in an interview that I watched, he talks about how this song is about moving on from looking for something, looking for a relationship.
I guess it's just about trying to move on from always looking for something and not letting it come to you when you... That's what you should do.
The idea to be content with who you are and let that special someone come to you. And in this track, that lesson takes the form of a man who is still in that initial stage. He is still learning and wishes that he were still wrapped around her finger. Moving on to a happier song, I Like You. Now, this is purely a love song. The album covers the highs and the lows of Post Malone's mental state, and this is one of the rare instances of a genuine high. It is a rare moment of bliss for him in this album. All he wants to do is spend time with this woman, and he hopes that she can somehow fit him into her schedule. I like you, I do. I hit you when I land, can you fit me in your plans? I like you. And in a twist for this song, we find out that this woman does have a boyfriend, but he fully intends on spending the time with her anyways. Yeah, your boyfriend, I never understand me, 'cause I'm about to pull this girl like a hammy. Now that he is famous and rich, he has so many surface level women who are totally willing to be with him, but he wants someone honest who can keep him grounded. And he asks her not to play games with him. Ironic considering he's asking her to cheat on her boyfriend. We then get the verse performed by Doja Cat. In the song, she plays the role of the woman that Post Malone is singing to. And she reciprocates those feelings and expresses a desire to meet up with him in order to, No, hey, get out of here, get. I don't know what that was about. As a matter of fact, they opt for a relationship that is exclusively that. Let me know when you're free, cause I've been trying to hit it all week, babe. And that's how the song ends. The two meet up and enjoy each other's company, and that is the end of it. Now moving on to a sadder song, I Cannot Be. I'm not sure if this is the same relationship as in the previous track, but in this track, he feels almost suffocated by his relationship. How am I free when you hold me so tight? How can I be when you block in my light? He can't be what she wants him to be, and so he feels very limited in this relationship. But she has also disappointed him in this relationship. He had hoped that she would keep him safe from the turbulent world outside and provide shelter for him, but she ended up stabbing him in the back anyways. And he blames her for his continued drug use in order to distract himself from the stress that he feels. You're the reason why I get so high. And then we get to the feature by Gunna. I feel so weird and I feel so white saying all of these names. Like, introducing Gunna. He echoes the sentiment of not wanting a woman who's just going to betray him in the end. I told her I don't need her, she can leave out my life. This woman wouldn't allow him to be himself, so he cut her off. Then Post repeats the chorus and we move on to the next track, Insane. Coming off the heels of the last two tracks, this is a very logical next step for his character. This track is unabashedly sung by the Post Malone persona, and he is back with a vengeance. Take your bitch, give her back, insane. This persona is mad at the world around him, and so he takes great joy in ruining the lives of others and the relationships of others. You're my bastard, I'm a bastard, hey, don't believe me. He's meeting women backstage at all of his shows, too. And while he has so many things in common with these women because of the fame and the status that he has, these things are also differences. Yeah, we both got a car, but it's different. Yeah, we both got a house, but it's different. Yeah, we both got teeth, but it's different. There's also a throwaway line about him cutting his hair off, just like he did with his ex. To my top. While the tone of the song is very trivial and very jovial, I do believe that this is a moment of honesty in an otherwise avoidant song, almost. It hints at the pain that is lurking beneath the surface that he is currently refusing to acknowledge. It fills the same role that Heartless did in the After Hours album. He is bitter and he ruins people's lives because a woman did that to him once. That doesn't make it right, but it does make it believable. Meanwhile, he surrounds himself with expensive jewelry and women, and he also has a throwaway line about keeping a gun with him at all times, too. Keep my cocky tied like a baby in a manger. When you're gone around me, she treats you like a stranger. People can threaten to stop him from what he's doing, but he knows that they're all talk and they won't do anything. Post Malone is rich and powerful, and no one is afraid of the people who would try and stop him. We then move from this track into Love-Hate Letter to Alcohol. The feature on this track is Fleet Foxes, an indie folk band. Fun fact, in an interview with Post Malone, he cites Fleet Foxes as a major inspiration for this album, as well as a band that he himself will listen to in his own time. This song is sung by the Austin persona, and he is recalling the events in his life that led him to losing his teeth. In fact, this could even be considered a direct follow-up to the previous track, Insane. He ends the previous track talking a very big game. I'm very big and impressive and no one can do anything about it. And then in this track, he opens talking about how he should have kept his words to himself.
Turns out I'm pretty good at running my mouth, but not good enough.
Now, the real world story for what happened is sometime in 2020 or 2021, he was at a bar, the music was playing too loud, and he got in a fight. And in the chorus, he speaks directly to the alcohol that he takes, that he drinks. He laments the fact that while the alcohol is the reason that he got into this pointless fight, it's also the only thing capable of drowning the depressing thoughts and feelings in his heart. He woke up on the ground bleeding, and he was driven home by some friends of his. He looked in the mirror and noticed that several of his teeth were missing. And that's when someone asked him what happened, and he recounts the events of the fight. After doing a bunch of shots, he got into a drunken brawl with a man. It's never said who, honestly, probably for the best. He swung at the man, but he was so drunk that he missed and lost his balance. And the person he was fighting, did not miss at all.
Fell out of my fucking chair, swinging for his eye. That big chrome ring flowing from the side.
The name of the album, 12 Karat Toothache, is fully representative of his mental state, but also his physical state. His success has brought him fame and money, but it has also brought him a ton of misery and stress. And when people see his expensive diamond teeth, they are jealous of his wealth, but to him, it's a painful reminder of the drunken brawl he got into because of the liquor that he uses to medicate his pain. The name of the album really is a double-edged sword. It's the money and the pain that comes with it, which is why I love the title of the album so much. We then move on to the track, Wasting Angels. This song is about looking back on what life was like before the fame and how surreal life feels now comparatively. In his reminiscing, Post makes the offhand comment about how he used to be sane before he was famous, but now life is just too crazy.
This is like when I was sane before the fame. This life is crazy.
And he talks about a summer fling that got away from him, and how in the future he vows to never let another angel like that go to waste.
This is like a summer flame that got away. I won't let another angel go to waste.
Meaning, when he next comes across a woman like that who was so good to him and good for him, this time he won't let her go. In this state of reflection, he is seeking to get a break from all of the fame, but the evidence of his fame is all around him. He sleeps in an expensive bed, and crowds of people always flock to his house to get a glimpse of him.
Waiting at the gate, had to get my address on my last nerve while I'm ripping cigarettes.
This line in particular might be referring to an instance where Jake Paul actually showed up to Post Malone's house to film him and kind of harass him, and his address got leaked, resulting in even more harassment. Insert joke about YouTubers doxing people and how bad it is. And moving on. I don't normally talk about drama surrounding the lines in an album, but any chance I get to use this YouTube platform to belittle Jake Paul, I consider an honor and a privilege. And in order to deal with the stress that all his fame has caused him, he resorts to smoking. He knows that it's bad for him, but he just needs something that can calm him down.
It's a killer, no, it's a killer, no. I just need a little something, get me through.
And it's all getting to be too much for him. Either he's not thinking about anything, or he's overthinking so much that he just spirals all day. And when he's drunk, he calls out for the woman who got away, wishing that she were still here with him.
I say your name when you're not around. When I'm drunk and my knees can't pick me up.
And then we get to the verse by the Kid Laroi.
I blacked out, left 100 missed calls on your phone. I mixed my drink with a couple of drugs.
Following the same idea as Post Malone, he is drunk calling the woman who got away in his life. Or maybe they're talking about the same woman and this is just one narrative. I don't know. She said that she hates him, but also misses the fact that he's not around anymore. Now, this may be a moment of unreliable narrator trickery, but I don't know. And in this twisted state that fame has put him in, he says he doesn't need good people around him to ground him. What he needs are enemies that will push him further and further away from his humanity. And for the outro of the song, it is just one phrase repeated over and over.
I should listen to you now if I never.
And this part of the song is honestly one of the highlights of the album for me. Between the production, the choir, the intense amount of reverb, and just the repetition of the same phrase, this outro gave me like an out-of-body experience when I listened to it for the first time. Maybe it's my Christian background, but I'm just a sucker for a song with a repeated bridge. And there is a meaning behind it, don't get me wrong, there is a purpose to it. This is a cry to the woman who left him, the one person in his life who made sense of the world. All he wishes with every fiber of his being is that he wish he had listened to her. But he didn't, and so she left. And now, at his wit's end, he cries out, wishing that he had listened. And that's how the song ends. We then seamlessly transition into the next track, Euthanasia. Now, if you couldn't tell by the track title, this is a pretty heavy one in the album. The downward spiral he's been on throughout this entire album has left him in a very deep depression. In the context of the other songs, this is sung by the Austin persona speaking from the lowest point in his life. In the song, he accidentally takes a sip out of his ash can, thinking that it's beer. See, sometimes when smokers don't have an ashtray to deposit their cigarettes and their cigarette ash in, they'll use an empty beer can instead. And so, right in the beginning of this song, he takes a sip straight out of that ash can. But in this state, he is so depressed that it didn't bother him at all.
Took a fucking sip from my ash can.
He leans over and spits another one of his broken teeth out into the trash can. He is falling apart at the seams, but he doesn't care. He doesn't have the strength to care. He has completely given up on taking care of himself. He's spent so long filling his body with substances and with alcohol that when he does die, he's convinced that he won't feel a thing.
When I go
This is the euthanasia that he's talking about in the song. See, normally euthanasia refers to killing an animal or a person in order to end their suffering, and this is done in a painless and very humane way. And in this song, he's directly calling his alcoholism and his drug abuse a form of emotional euthanasia. He is suffering mentally, but he uses all of these things to kill it off. And as he sits alone, he basks in this moment, one of the rare moments in his life nowadays that he is sober.
Behold a sober moment. Too short for tweet.
And as he's enjoying this moment of sobriety, he thinks about celebrating it by opening another beer.
I should cry.
He views this euthanasia as a cure to his anger. Whether that's anger at himself or anger for the people around him, I'm not sure. Maybe both.
Anger. Euthanasia.
That's really all there is in terms of lyrical content for this track, but the production in itself also sets the tone perfectly. A repeating piano note mimics the sound of a harp monitor. Meanwhile, the low-end drums mimic the beat of a harp. And towards the very end of the song, the harp monitor gets slower and slower until finally it cuts off. And throughout the song, the synths that he uses create this very dark and oppressive fog almost in the soundscape. This is likely representative of the depression that he's feeling. It is raw emotional and mental experience portrayed through music. And while it is very heavy, it is also brilliantly executed. We then go to the next track, When I'm Alone. This track centers around Post Malone's regrets towards a past relationship. It appears that he was unfaithful and in doing so caused the death of a good relationship. And now, in his destroyed and fractured state, he wants her back, even though he knows it's impossible. Thanks to him, the only home that he had in her went up in smoke, and now he has to live with that. My own home went down in smoke. It's been sweet, I tasted. And he's slowly beginning to work through it, to the point where his memory of her is beginning to fade. I'm unsure if this is because of the substance abuse or because he's actually moving on. We never know. And even when he's alone, he pretends to himself that he is over it. But every time he wakes up, it hurts because he knows that he's not with her. And he flashes back over and over again in his mind to the moment when he was unfaithful. He admits to himself that he was looking for it and she found him. They spent the night together and afterwards he took her home, but it appears as though she left something in his car that his girlfriend noticed. And my baby found out now I'm living in a hotel. He recalls after this having to live in a hotel room for a time, and he jokes about how he was living good in the hotel. Ain't that bad, I got room service, living in the hotel, living in the hotel. And now, in the present, in vain, he is reaching out to her again. His life is worse without her there, and the fame does not help him. Life is sour even when I'm in the light right now, but I try somehow. And then we get to the next track, Waiting for a Miracle. This is probably the most heavy track on the album, as it is a depiction of his absolute rock bottom moment. And I am unsure if this is a real event that happened with him or if it's just something that he very largely considered, but this is a track where he debates just ending it all right there. And in this moment, he prays that God would just take the gun out of his hands. Oh my God. Just take fire off of me. He's ready to go through with it, but he is terrified and looking for any reason at all not to do it. He loads a round into the gun and closes his eyes. I'm scared to die, I'm away, so I close my eyes. And as he sits there, he reflects on our culture's treatment of the dead. And everything done for the dead after the dead is for the living. In his mind, all of the ceremony and circumstance we have for the passing of someone is purely for the benefit of the people attending, not the person who is gone now. And he says that when he dies, he wants them to throw a party. Fuck me up. Fuck it, get fucked up. He never cared about his body in life, so why should he care now that he's dead? And that's where the track ends. There's no resolution, there's no big redemption moment. It's just him alone in a room at his darkest point, begging for a miracle. And that is a very heavy subject and something that I don't want to take lightly. So before moving on to the next track of the album, I do want to just say personally that you as a person do matter to the people around you and to everyone you come into contact with. You are important. If anyone watching this video is feeling in a similar headspace or has debated something like this, I have included in the description down below the numbers that are available that you can call, because it does suck feeling like you're alone. And so if you need to reach out, absolutely do that, because you are very important. And there are people that care about you and people that will care about you if you let them in. I promise. And with that said, we're going to move into the next track of the album, One Right Now. This is a track performed together with The Weeknd, who I have done videos on in the past and you can watch on this very channel. In this song, the two are singing about a woman who's cheated on them but wants them back. Said you love me, but I don't care. You can't mess around and expect everything to be fine afterwards, which is a very ironic song and a very ironic message considering some of the other songs in this album about wanting someone back after doing the same thing. In fact, The Weeknd talks in this song about having a woman with him right now and another one on the way. I got one. And in his verse, Post Malone talks about how him and this woman used to plan a future together, but after what she did, he's done putting up with her. Don't call me baby when you did me so wrong. And now he is back to his womanizing tendencies, partly as a way to cope with it, but also as a sort of revenge against her. I don't know what I tried to say there. And in The Weeknd's verse, he kind of insults the woman, saying that she probably runs around with all of his enemies, and so he can't have her close to him. You're a stain of my legacy. We can't be friends, can't be family. And at the end of the track, they both let her go and repeat the chorus. We then come to the final track of the album, New Recording 12, January 3rd, 2020. Compared to the radio hit that One Right Now is, this is a very sobering close to the album, because this track was a voice memo recorded on Post Malone's phone in January of 2020. And in it, he is heard putting his phone down and beginning to play a very melancholy tune on his guitar. And as he begins to sing, we realize that this was an early demo recording for the song Euthanasia. And I do have a few theories regarding this track in particular. The first is that I believe this initial recording was the inspiration that kicked off this whole album, 12 Karat Toothache, seeing as it was recorded 2 years before the release of the album. And in doing research for this video, I came across an interview where Post Malone says that this recording that we hear in the album was the first recording done for the album.
And is that the original voice note?
Yes, sir. That's the one from the room that I did. That was a rough night for me.
The other theory I have is that in the studio produced version of Euthanasia, he is singing about being in his darkest point, but I believe that this recording was taken directly during that dark moment. His voice is very weak and very raw, as if he is feeling all of these emotions that he's singing about. There's also one lyrical change between the two versions. Instead of saying that he didn't bother keeping himself in touch, he says this. Don't bother keeping in touch. It's a small change, but in this mental state, it seems as though he is actively pushing people away. And my final theory is about why he included this track in the first place, especially as the outro for 12 Karat Toothache. This comes after a very optimistic and upbeat pop song, which other artists may have chosen as the final track for their album. I think the inclusion of this track at the very end is to show the listeners that those feelings, those dark, depressing thoughts he has, have never gone away. Even if he is in a better spot, those feelings still persist in some way. This could also serve as a reminder for the listeners. In showing the highs and the lows of himself, he is showing people that even though those feelings may never truly go away, things can get better from there. But with that, we have come to the very end of 12 Karat Toothache. Now, those familiar with the album will know that there was a deluxe version released with two extra tracks as well. And in my analysis of After Hours, I included the bonus tracks that were in the deluxe version of that album because I believed that they still incorporated themselves into the narrative well, or they had their place in the story that I was telling you all. And while I do like the two tracks from the deluxe version of the album, Hateful and Waiting for Never, I don't think they add much to the story that I'm trying to tell. And personally, I find the closing on the new recording voice memo to be much more impactful. So I'm just going to leave my analysis here. And now for, I guess, what would be my thesis for the album. You may have noticed throughout the album that the emotions of the album seem to turn on a dime. There will be these very heavy tracks about Post Malone's struggles with fame and drugs and depression, and then it will immediately transition into like a optimistic, upbeat radio hit. This album goes all over the place emotionally and sonically, and I have two explanations for that. The first is one that I've been talking about throughout the video, and that is the theory of two speakers. First, there is Post Malone, who revels in his success. He likes bragging about the parties and the women and all the expensive stuff that he can afford. He is the 12 karat personality, making hits and feeling great the whole time. And then there is Austin Post, the man behind the artist. The life of fame he's lived up until this point has left him very drained and very depressed. He is caught in this very abusive cycle with fame. He is the toothache of the album, suffering from the consequences of his own actions. Or, if you want to take the two speakers thing a little more literally, he's suffering for the consequences of Post Malone's actions. I'm not saying that he's actually, like, has a divided personality. I'm not saying that. I don't think that's true at all. These two versions of himself are constantly battling to be heard throughout this album, thus creating a paradox. There is the high and the crash, the pleasure and the pain, the 12 karat fame and the toothache. And my other theory around why the album is the way that it is a little bit more literal and involves the expectations of record labels. See, I've heard rumors and speculation around this album regarding studio interference when making the album. Now, I've done my digging, and to be fair, I couldn't find any credible sources to back this up, so it could just be baseless accusation, but I do believe it is a possibility. Ultimately, the record companies are the people who pay artists, and in order to make money to pay artists, they need to sell records. And so, in my mind, it's not entirely out of the question that the studio would not greenlight a project that is exclusively a depressing introspection on fame and its consequences on this one individual. Thus, we have Post Malone trying to make this meaningful album about himself while also having to balance that with making radio hits and marketable songs. He even kind of makes remarks hinting at this in Reputation. Another very damning piece of evidence that I find in this album to support that theory is that some of the lyrical content in his radio hit, like upbeat tracks in this album, are quite frankly, lazy.
Second verse again.
Now, this is not a comment directed to Post himself. I know for a fact that he is an amazing singer and songwriter, and he is capable of producing very deep lyrical content. What I'm saying is that he put effort into the songs that he wanted to write, and possibly in an act of passive aggression, wrote rather lazily on the tracks that he was less focused on. Now, those are my two theories, but which do I actually believe? And to be honest, I feel like both of them in a way are true. Post wanted to create an album surrounding his raw emotions and struggles, and when the studio wouldn't let him or wouldn't greenlight it unless there were radio hits in the album, he made an album that is intentionally at war with itself. Just like the two aspects of himself, Post and Austin, are at war with each other. However, I really enjoyed the result. I think this is a great album with some great tracks on it. And I think the struggle that this album had only made his next album that much more special. Because in his most recent album, Austin, he was able to tell his story completely unimpeded. And I'll probably do a video on it in the future, but let me just say this right here, right now. Austin, in my opinion, is the best Post Malone album of all time. Each track is expertly produced and written, and it really embodies, both sonically and lyrically, everything that I've enjoyed about Post Malone's albums up until this point. And as great as it is, I do think the impact of Austin would be lessened without 12 Karat Toothache coming first. The whole album is a battle between the vulnerable Austin and the vice-fueled Post Malone. And the next album being titled Austin is a nod to that. This album is completely Austin, unabridged. He's gone through the dark moments and the struggles, and Austin is all about the healing journey afterwards. Also, this doesn't really need to be said in this video, but I'm gonna say it anyways. It's my channel, I can do what I want. After doing a bunch of research for this video, diving into his songs, watching live performances, and listening to interviews that he's given, I feel like I can say with a good degree of certainty that on top of being an amazing artist, Post is just a really, really nice guy. He's very nice and appreciative to his fans. When he's being interviewed, he always calls the interviewer sir. He seems very kind and a very respectful person. I don't mean to say this in a parasocial way or in a cringy Sigma, oh, he's just like me way, but I do see a lot of traits in Post Malone that I relate to and empathize with.
I have so many hugs. I have literally infinite hugs.
You just gotta like...
Infinite hugs, guys.
You're a great hugger.
Seriously, if you need a hug, just come on up. I'll give you a good hug.
All that to say, he seems great, and I would love to go see him in concert one day. This has been the Crisis of Identity and the Dark Struggle of Post Malone in 12 Karat Toothache. And if you've made it this long, thank you so much for watching. It really means the most that you're here at the end of the video and that you have considered this video worth your time. It means the world. We just reached, as of today when I'm recording this video, 400 subscribers. So thank you all so much for your support. We are only going to keep going from here. I have no plans of stopping anytime soon, and we're only going to keep going upwards. And of course, a huge thank you to the patrons, Sean and my top tier patrons, RD and Snowy. Thank you all so much for supporting me and my content and my goal of being able to do this full time with you all. So thank you all so much for watching, and I will see you next week for another video. I hope you're excited for that because I know that I am. And cut.